quiet, please. Please be fully attentive. Please give me the patience hearing, please. Subhanallah. There are some misconceptions regarding the Mi'raj al-Nabi. I would like to make it as clear as the sun of midday. What the misconceptions are, that there are some people who have firm belief that the Mi'raj al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not take place. The naturalist people, they don't believe about the Mi'raj al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they say it is impossible for a person to go all the way from Mecca to Jerusalem, Jerusalem to seven heavens and the Siddhul Muntaha and Lamaka, Qaba Qawsain. It is impossible for a prophet to go. So they basically they deny and then refuse that the Mi'raj al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever has taken place. But now if we look at the recited verse with its full context, in its full context, the answer is very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Asra bi'abdihi. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never, ever claimed that I went to Mi'raj by myself. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we took him. Now, if the question is that if it is impossible for the Prophet, what is the impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take? Because wallahu ala kulli shayin qadir, Allah has power over everything. So if you say that it is impossible for a Prophet to go, so I don't think there is any impossibility for the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah has power over everything, and Allah himself says in the verse that we took him for the Mi'raj, and we took him for the excursion and for ascension. Now another angle of this story is, of this objection is, that imagine the next day when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to his tribe or the people of Quraysh, and they say, and he said that last night Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took me for Mi'raj. So imagine the kuffar of that time, I think they have more strong belief than these naturalists. Because if it was just a dream, or if it was just a spiritual, if it was just a, okay, now there's another question. That question is there. But now the another question is that there are some people who believe that Mi'raj al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took place. Mi'raj al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took place. But it was just a physical, it was just a spiritual Mi'raj. It was just a Mi'raj in the dream. It was not a physical dream, not a physical one. So now, the question is that in the footnote of the Jalalain Sharif, one of the most authentic, short and sweet commentary of the Quran, Jalalain Sharif, the textbook, in its commentary on its footnote, it has been written that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed his prophet with the dream or the spiritual Mi'raj 33 times. And this was the 34th Mi'raj, which was the physical one as well. So now, some people they say it was just a spiritual Mi'raj, it was not a physical Mi'raj. And I think this aqidah is almost like overwhelming, you know, wherever, especially the new generation or the modern, like, you know, scholars, they bring all these issues, all the controversial issues. In fact, it is unanimous now, but intentionally they are making it like disputed, making it controversial. There must be some strong reason behind. Allah knows better. So they believe that it was just a spiritual Mi'raj, not a physical Mi'raj. Now again, the answer, the verse itself proves that it was the physical one, not the spiritual one. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Asra bi'abdihi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his most beloved servant. It didn't say, Asra bi'ruhihi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his soul, took his spirit. No, Allah says he took most beloved slave like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this verse itself proves that it was the physical miraj, not just the spiritual miraj. And now we came to the point what I was sharing with you, that now even the kuffar of that time, because the next day when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that last night Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took me for the miraj, so they refused. If it was just the spiritual or just the dream miraj, I don't think there was any point to refuse. Because that kind of thing, even sometimes, you know, a person can go as much as he can fly, you see, in the dream. So it means the kuffar, they have believed, you know, that it was the physical journey. That's why, you know, they rejected it. And now what happened? Ultimately, they went to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and now they wanted to confuse Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now the group of the prominent kuffar and the Quraysh, they went to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and they asked him, Abu Bakr, tell us, because you are a very wise person in the Arabian Peninsula, you must tell us that if a person claims that he was taken for a journey from Mecca to Jerusalem, Jerusalem to seven heavens, and Siddhul Muntaha Baba Qawsain, it is possible. I said, no. How can it be possible? He said, never. Oh, they say, we got him, you see. They realized we got him. So they said, okay, now this is what happened. You know, your very intimate friend, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this is what he is claiming. He said, He says, Wallahi, لَئِنْ كَانَ قَالَهُ لَقَدْ صَدَقْ. If he, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he has said so, it must be so. Is that the 100%? 110%, you know. Afterwards, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, neither he gave them any proof, nor he listened to any of their nonsense, you see. He just went straight to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And from that day onwards, you know, because of his verification, because of his certification, he became the Siddiq. Up until now, we name him Abu Bakr Siddiq because of this special event, you know. Because when the people were puzzled, confused, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu claimed that if the Prophet had said so, it must be so. Subhanallah. Now, another point related with this is, time is running very fast, Mashtar. So, another proof of those people who reject the physical miraj of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they said, look, there is a narration by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, where she mentions that on the night of miraj, the body of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never separated from me. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't miss me, or I didn't miss the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that night. Subhanallah. This is one of the strong proof of the rejector of the physical miraj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now you can understand, Jamaat al-Muslimin, that imagine, we say in Urdu, Daroh go rahafza nabashal, rather in Persian, we say, Daroh go rahafza nabashal. The person who lies has no brain, you see. The person who lies has no memory. So imagine, as I said in earlier, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken for this miraj because of all the calamities, all these difficulties that he faced. And even at that time, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was not even the married with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see. So how can a person claim that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha is claiming that I never missed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he was never separated on that night, subhanallah. Now, okay, supposing it is an authentic tradition. Let's say it is authentic tradition, you see. So again, the answer can be that it shows the swiftness of the miraj. Swift, how fast it took place that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and came back, and she didn't even realize, you see. And also, we say in Urdu, zanjeer bhi hilti rahi, bistar bhi raha garam. It shows the swiftness of this great journey, that when So when he locked the house of Umm Hani, so the chain of the door was still in motion when the Prophet ﷺ got back from the Miraj. So it shows how swift and how fast this journey was, you know, subhanAllah. So in any case, the answer is ready, you know, for all the objections of the rejecter of the Miraj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the third thing what I wanted to share with you is that the point what I said, that why this journey took place in night, it's a very important. Why this journey took place in a night time, not a day time, subhanAllah. But to understand the profound meaning of this fact, we must understand that this journey, from its totality, it was a journey of love. It was journey of affection, journey of mahabbah. And you know that the night is the best time for beloved and lover to come closer, you see. From the love point of view, it is a great time when they come together, they converse, they speak, or they meet. And this is what happened on the night of Miraj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now another thing is that the night provides seclusion, the retreat, the khalwa, the calm and serene, which the night can provide, the day can never. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected night for His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take him for excursion. The third point is that imagine, night, subhanAllah, is so blessed that all the as-sa'atul maqbula, all the precious moment in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers the bounties or He accepts the du'as, Allah has placed it in the night. Imagine, Laylatul Bara'ah, we are going to have next month. It is a Layla, it is a night. And it is so blessed night that when the night falls, from that time after the Maghrib till to daybreak, only the mercies and the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends from the sky to the people. So the night is so blessed, and imagine that the Salatul Tahajjud also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the night. If a person performs 1,000 rak'ah in the day and he wants to take the reward of tahajjud, he's not going to get ever. He has to wake up and he has to perform in the night. And moreover, Laylatul Qadr itself is better than the 1,000 months. Just one night is better than the 1,000 nights, subhanAllah. So what I'm trying to say and what I'm trying to explain, that imagine, nights are so blessed. Just because of this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected night to take His most beloved slave, most beloved servant for the Mi'raj. And another thing is that even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by Himself is a very interesting point. The Hadith Sharif says that every night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to His own state, how and where, we don't know. Allah knows better. Because being a Muslim, we have to believe how and where. But Allah knows how and where. Kaif and Ain, we don't know. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the third night, the third part of the night is passed, like midnight, and third portion of the night, when it's passed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself descends from the lowest dunya, lowest heaven, or lowest sama, lowest sky of the dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends and comes to change our destiny, to change our problem, to shower the mercies. But look, we claim that we are loving and we are sleeping. Can you believe it? The beloved is coming to knock our door and we are sleeping, subhanAllah. And this is the case at every night. But these two nights, like Laylatul Bara'ah and Laylatul Qadr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He descends according to His own status from the Maghrib till to Matla'il Fajr. So imagine, like, the night is so blessed. that Allah's tajalli and anwar even come and descend you on that night. And because of these reasons, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected night to take his most beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the Mi'raj. And now another interesting point is that imagine one of the reasons to go to Jannah is also has a deep relevant with the night as well. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامُ. Feed the people. Feed the people. Join the feeding scheme. Assist the people who feed the people. Now, أَفْشُ السَّلَامُ. Spread the salam amongst you. If you really want to go to the Jannah, my brother, please listen and please act upon what our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. He said, أَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامُ. Feed the people. وَأَفْشُ السَّلَامُ. And spread salam amongst you. وَسَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ. And perform the salah at the night when the people are sleeping. So imagine, it has also a relevant with the entrance of the Jannah as well, you see, subhanAllah. You know, that really if you want to go to the Jannah, then we have to select the one portion of the night to perform the salah, which can entitle us to go to the Jannah. SubhanAllah. So because of all these, you know, many reasons, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has selected the night, you know, for his most beloved Prophet, for the Miraj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the last thing what I said, and that's very interesting, because I read the most of the translations of the Quran, but they have written the translation just Laylan in the night. But I don't think, you know, it is a perfect or it is a meaningful or it fits, you know, with this story. Because the story says in a very short amount of time, all this journey took place, as I explained earlier. But now, and also Allah didn't say like fil layli. Bi abdihi fil layli. Laylan. And the ulama says the tanween of the laylan is with taqleel, is to show in how short amount of time this great or this long or this tremendous journey took place. But now for this reason or for this point, for this theme, if you really want to understand, then we have to understand the theory of relativity. Or even before, I would like you to become acquainted with the three Islamic terms which call Tayyi Zaman, Tayyi Makan, and Tayyi Lisan. And it is so interesting that if you want to really understand that these three philosophic terms, you will really enjoy with it. Tayyi Zaman and the Miraj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a deep relevance with these three terms as well. So if we're gonna get it, so the Miraj Nabi's story will really give you a tremendous meaning as well. So now, Tayyi Zaman. Tayyi Zaman means the reduction, not the expansion, not the expansion, contraction. The contraction of space. Tayyi Makan, contraction of space or reduction of space. Tayyi Zaman, reduction of time. And Tayyi Lisan, reduction of the tongue. And these three things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed with different awliya kiram, different prophets, different messengers. And the proof, because the proof has to be very solid, you know. And the proof is Quran Azimushan. Imagine, read the story of the people of the Kahf. That story will tell you how does the theory of this relativity works. Like what I said, that the reduction of time, contraction of time, means how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reduces the time for his believers. Now imagine, the people of the Kerala, people of Kerala, because they were living in a society which was completely corrupt society, and even the ruler was very tyrant. So they decided to leave that area. They decided to leave that society. Now they escaped from the society and they refused in a cave. That cave called the cave of the Kerala, the cave. The people of the people of the cave, the people of the cave. So they refused in the cave. Now, when they went into the cave to protect their aqidahs, to protect, you know, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because only these groups were the Muslims or were submitting themselves towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rest of the community was polytheist, were the mushriks. Now what happened was, that when they went, when they entered into that cave, I was making it very short so that we can finish it at the time, inshallah Rahman. So when they reached or when they entered into that cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused them to sleep. They slept. Now, when they woke up, so they puzzled, you know, and they asking each other, let us know, tell me, how long did we stay in this cave? So one group is saying, oh, 1 year? So the another day, no, it's too long, you see. Maybe a portion of the day, you see. We spend in this cave, maybe like, you know, a portion of the day. But in fact, how long did they sleep? 309 years. 309 years they slept in that cave. So imagine that 309 years was not for them, it was for the rest of the world. But the very same amount of the time for them, it was just a day or less than a day. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reduces the time for his beloveds. Now the another story which shows that is the reduction of the time is the story of the Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam. When Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam passing a ruin or destroyed a perished village or the city, when he reached to that point, he started thinking that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to resurrect the people. He started thinking and he was riding his donkey and he was carrying his fresh meal as well with him, along with him. So now what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused him to die on the spot. He died there. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him into life, he asked him, because he was the prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala communicated direct with him. Come, Nabi. Oh my beloved, how long did you stay in the city? Very same answer. Yawman aw ba'da yawm. A day or less than a day. But you know, in fact, how long he spent or how long he slept or